And I'm going to present our research, which it's also a little bit different from both previous talks, which it's really nice because I think we have like a really wide picture of like self-assembly on many different types of applications. So in my case, I will show you some examples on the things that we have been doing towards energy conversion and this idea of how self-assembly can help us in order to get more efficient catalysts or how we can get more efficient ways of converting energy in the nanoscale. Okay, so as the audience might be quite broad and with like many different profiles, I decided to start with a really brief introduction on catalysis, on things that you may have probably heard before. So here, these stripes here, so each of these lines here, it's 1 year from 1850 to 2018, and the average temperature of that year, it's color-coded from like blue to red. So blue is cold weather and red is hotter. And we can see here clearly how in the last 20, 30 years, we have had a huge temperature increase around the world, right? So we all know this problem. And of course, it has to be with many different things. So fossil fuels, greenhouse gases, fertilizers, all these things contributing towards global warming. So I just selected a couple of numbers for you to have an idea on some striking numbers. So 80%, this 80% means that 80% of the energy that we used for our daily life, for our cars, for our machines, for our computer, for our Zoom, for everything, have seen a catalyst before reaching us. So this is already one important thing because 80% of the energy that we normally use nowadays have seen a catalyst before reaching us. This 405 ppm, it's the level of CO2 in the atmosphere, which is the highest level in the last 800,000 years that has been measured. So we are now in a condition that has the world has not seen before, right? In terms of like the level of CO2 that we have. And finally, this is a number that I found recently, which you may have heard before or not, but it's really striking. And it's that, you know, that our bodies cannot process nitrogen. So we need to incorporate nitrogen into our body for creating our cells, DNA and tissues by fertilizers, right? By the food. And one out of two nitrogens that we have now in our body have a Bosch catalyst before reaching us. So that means that the half of the nitrogen content that we have in our body right now saw or touched a catalyst before, right? So that came from the fertilizers idea. So all this shows us that we are kind of like in a bad cycle of the economy because we have the fossil fuels, greenhouse gases and fertilizers that contributes against our life and our economy. And we can change this into the positive cycle or like this idea of like circular economy, right? So how we can use all these things in order to transform them into useful chemicals or into useful ways of energy that do not harvest us. And for that, we need new ways of catalyzed reactions. We need new catalysts. And of course, this is a huge field, right? So heterogeneous catalysis, it's a huge field. And it's a really old field that has been looking at different ways of catalyzing reactions, different materials. But in my talk here, I want to show you some results of my group in the last couple of years on something that is quite new, which is the idea of using plasmonics for photocatalysis. And if you think about, there are not too many materials that can get absorb photons in the visible regime as efficient as plasmonic materials. So the idea of having a really good material for absorbing visible photons turns this material, these plasmonic materials, into important ways of catalyzing sunlight into chemical reaction. So the idea is that, of course, the sun emits mostly in the visible regime, and we don't have too many materials that efficiently absorb the visible regime. So why don't we use these materials in order to absorb those photons and try to do photocatalysis with them? Because this would be a super clean way of doing catalysis, right? Compared to high temperatures that you can reach with like fossil fuels or like high pressure conditions. Here we just need the sunlight, but then we need to find a way in order to transform that those photons or that energy into chemical energy. And for that, if we think about these plasmonic photocatalysts, we can see that when we excite these plasmonic materials, there are many different phenomena that are triggered at the same time on the material. So we have on one side high electric field confinement, We all know this, right? For like surface enhanced Raman or like many of the applications of plasmonics rely indeed in this electric field confinement from the light into these hotspots of these plasmonic structures. But we also have absorption of the energy, right? So not only scattering, but also absorption of the energy inside the material. And that absorption inside the material can create electron hole pairs, as we will see now. And these electron hole pairs act in a similar way as in a semiconductor, where you have an electron hole pair that can react with a molecule on the surface. We also have catalytic sites because we have mostly metal structures, right? So gold, silver, platinum, well, gold, silver, aluminum, copper, right? Those are the plasmonic materials, but we can further decorate this with like catalytic materials, as I will show you. We also have phonons in the materials. And finally, we end up heating the material, right? So we know that these plasmonic materials are really good in converting light into heat. But all of these phenomena can help in order to assist chemical reactions. And in particular, the one of absorption and the generation of hot carriers has been recently looked in quite detail by the literature and by many groups in the world. And the idea behind that, it's not new, right? So I will just briefly summarize what we think or what how we understand this, right? So we have a molecule that it's in the ground state, and by receiving an electron or a hole from the nanoparticle, we can access to the excited electronic state of the molecule. And in that excited electronic state, the activation barrier of a reaction, which here in the ground state, it's this red line. And of course, this is achieved by heating up the system, right? So that's how you normally do catalysis. You just cross this activation barrier by heating the system and reaching the product B. But if we are able to access to the excited state of that molecule, in the excited state, it has been shown that the activation barriers are much lower than in the ground state. So that means that we need much less energy in order to get to the product. But also we have new minima in the excited state curve. So that means that we can have selectivity towards other products of the reaction. So basically by accessing to the excited electronic state of the molecule, we can have a new landscape that we can explore in terms of activation barriers and products of the reaction. Of course, this is not new. It's not exactly photochemistry. It's not the same principle, but it's similar to photochemistry. But the idea of phonons versus electrons, right? Because here in the ground state, it's most temperature, it's phonon driven the reaction, while in the other case, it's like photon driven. This is not new, right? So this has been spotted already like more than 20 years ago by the Nobel Prize Gerard Earle, where they studied this idea of like phonon versus electron mediated reactions, right? And in that case, they have seen exactly what I've just shown you, right? That if you are in the ground state and you activate the pathway through temperature, then you have a huge activation barrier, while if you are able to access to the excited state by transferring electrons, then you can reduce the activation barrier of the reaction. But if you look at here, they achieve this on a material which is not plasmonics, right? So it's a ruthenium catalyst, but also using a femtosecond laser. So even this is, of course, really interesting, and it's the door for many things that came after this. It's still quite far from the idea of sunlight-driven catalysis, right? Because we are using here a femtosecond laser, and we need much more power in order to reach to this effect. So the new thing is that quite recently it has been shown that plasmons can make that. So plasmons can create in the decay of the plasmon these electron hole pairs that can excite the molecules into the excited state, and can lead to new potential energy surface in order to get new reactivity of the molecules. And the good idea and the good point of this is that plasmons can be excited with continuous wave lasers in the visible regime in a condition which is much closer to sunlight-driven chemistry than before. So for that reason, plasmons have received quite a lot of attention recently due to these things. Oh, I don't know if you're seeing what. And if we think all the phenomena that happens on these plasmonic nanoparticles when exciting with light, you can see that plasmons can be excited. And after the excitation, there are many channels where the plasmon can decay, finally heating up the temperature, heating the media, right, or the surface of the catalyst. But in the middle, there are many things like the hot carriers that we just mentioned, the phonons of the material, right? So all these are energy pathways in where the plasmon that has been excited can decay during the process of excitation and decay of the plasmons. And as I said, this set us by exciting plasmonic materials one step closer of doing sunlight-driven catalysis. And this is what we have been working quite a lot and many other groups in the world quite recently on the idea of using sunlight excitation and these type of materials in order to get more efficient or selective ways of doing catalysis. So I will quickly show you a couple of examples of things that we have recently done following this idea and this direction, right? So one of the simplest examples is this one where we just put some single nanoparticles. And here I want to stress something, and is that the mechanisms of catalysis are so complex in these systems because we have so many different pathways for the energy that we have tried in the last couple of years to work at the single particle level, because working at the single particle level allow us to completely rule out any kind of like collective phenomena from the nanoparticles, but also allow us to have a really deep characterization of the nanoparticles, because we can know exactly the size, the shape, the composition of the nanoparticles. So it's much easier to try to understand the phenomena if we work at the single particle level than working in an ensemble condition. But of course, working at the single particle level, it's quite challenging because we don't need to only access to the optical states of the particle or to the optical properties of the nanoparticle, but also we need to access to the chemical composition because we are doing some chemical reaction on the nanoparticle. And tracking the chemical composition changes at the single particle level, it's really challenging. Not only for us, but also for the heterogeneous catalysis world, it's also really challenging to do single particle catalysis because you have a really small amount of molecules that you can trace or that you can check if they change with like different conditions. So here I just show you one example in where we use dark field spectroscopy and microscopy in order to follow the reaction on top of a single nanoparticle. So here we have gold nanoparticles, we have two nanoparticles, and we have a potential, right? So this is on an electrochemical cell, and by applying voltage, what happened is that we have the monomer of a polymer here, and when we reach the polymerization potential, the reaction takes place and the polymer coats completely the nanoparticles. So we can see that in the dark field scattering spectra of these single nanoparticles, and we can see that when we reach the electropolymerization potential, the polymer forms around the nanoparticles and that changes the scattering of the particles. So we repeat exactly the same, but now by illuminating one of the nanoparticles, the other one is the control particle, and by illuminating one at the plasmon resonance, and what we saw is that we can perform the reaction at a lower voltage, right? So this is typically an electrocatalytic process. So we have a catalytic mediated process by illuminating the plasmon modes of this nanoparticle. And you can see that also in the spectra, right? That the polymerization start taking place at a lower voltage compared than before. And of course we check this. So this is how much it changed the plasmon mode or the scattering peak, right? Compared to the voltage. And here we have in dark and we have the current of the system. And when you illuminate, what happens is that the changes happen at lower voltage. So there is an electrocatalytic effect. So we checked at the single particle level, the spectra of the polymer that is formed in each case. And we saw always the same type of polymer. So we are creating exactly the same species in every case. But the important thing is that we repeat exactly that, but at different excitation wavelengths, and we compensate in each case by the different absorption in the nanoparticle. So for example, when we use the 405 laser, we put much more power than in the case of the plasmon because here the absorption is much less. So all these points here are taken at exactly the same surface temperature. So at different powers, but at exactly the same absorbed energy. So the amount of energy absorbed in the material is the same, but we clearly see that the contribution to the reaction is not the same. And that it's because the absorption mechanism at each wavelength is completely different. So for example, at 400, we are mostly having interband type of absorption in the material. While in the case of the plasmon excitation, we are mostly having lambda damping as the absorption channel. So here we can see that depending on which is the absorption channel in the nanoparticle, it's the effect that it will have on the catalytic properties of the material. So I will just briefly show you quickly without entering in too much details, different type of methods that we have been, well, developing in the last couple of years in order to study single particle energy transfer or energy process at the single particle level. So we have worked with like all the different channels that I mentioned before. So we have studied the phonons of the particles, so the movement of the nanoparticles once the plasmon is being excited. This is in collaboration with Professor Andrea Bragas in the University of Buenos Aires in Argentina. And here, this is one of the channels in where the phone, in where the plasmon can decay, right? So, or this is the channel, one of the channels in the cascade of processes that it's present. So it's important for us to understand how we can change or how we can modulate this phonon decay of the plasmons. We have also done thermal imaging of nanoparticles. So trying to get a map of the temperature around a single nanoparticle by exciting with different wavelengths or at different powers on different substrates or different type of nanoparticles. So this is a collaboration with a group of Fernando Stefani, also in Buenos Aires, and Guillermo Acuña in Switzerland. And we have then moved into techniques that allow us to see the chemical reactivity of the surface. So we have followed dark field microscopy and spectroscopy, as I show you now in the example for the polymerization reaction. But we have also used this idea by metal deposition, right? So depositing a metal around the nanoparticle that will also change the dark field scattering properties of the nanoparticle. So as another way of checking the chemical composition of the particle in situ. And of course, we have used SEM, EDX techniques in order to map the chemical reactivity on the surface of these plasmonic nanoparticles after illumination. So this is really fast and really explained in a superficial way, but it has been really challenging to design and to develop all these methods in order to access to this detailed information at the single particle level. Finally, we have used optical techniques, of course, so super resolution imaging and single particle Raman enhanced spectroscopy in order to also follow chemical reactions on the surface of this catalyst. So where the reactions are taking place or how the reactions are taking place by using these type of methods. So of course, all these methods to study or to analyze the energy transfer are mainly done with the idea of fabricating better catalysts for the future. And for that, we need to rethink a little bit the colloidal synthesis, right? So we have done for the last 20 years, the community have worked a lot on designing better plasmonic nanoparticles for many different types of applications, mostly for sensing. But now we want to have plasmonic nanoparticles, but for catalysis, which is a completely different way of approaching the synthesis. Because we need not only to get the photons from the sun, but we also need to transfer those photons into the molecule or that energy into the molecule, right? So the idea of combining plasmonic and catalytic materials appeared quite recently in the literature in order to explore further how the energy can be transferred from one to the other place. And in that we have been working on trying to couple plasmonic materials with different catalytic materials in different types of arrangements. And I will show you only two examples on how we think on a different way the idea of creating these plasmonic particles. So this is a collaboration with a group of Professor Han in KAIST in Korea. And here the idea is that we can create reactors. So each of the nanoparticles is a reactor where the reaction is taking place on the surface under the plasmon illumination. And here we have created, for example, this particle in a frame structures. So we have this central gold particle that is surrounded by a gold frame. And the field enhancement in this particle is huge, but also the amount of surface area available for the molecules is much higher than in a complete closed nanoparticle, right? Or in this case, for example, where we have created these trimer structures, because we know that hotspots are really important in this plasmonic catalysis because the field inside the nanoparticle is highly enhanced by these hotspots, not only the field outside, but also the field inside of the nanoparticles. And then we have coated them, for example, with a catalytic shell or a catalytic material like palladium or platinum in order to reduce the activation barrier of the reaction once the molecules adsorb on the surface. So we are combining properties of different materials with the idea of using the photons from the sun and finally get a chemical output. Okay, so we have tried also to combine this with top-down methods, not only bottom-up, but also top-down methods. For us that we work on single particle level, top-down methods are really useful because we can control really tightly the gaps of the structures, the orientation of the structures. We can create arrays of the nanoparticles, which allow us to work much better at the single particle level. And we have recently started to combine both things. So bottom-up methods with top-down methods. So this is a bit more like on the self-assembly idea, right? So we have created these electrodes with catalytic nanoparticles, plasmonic catalytic nanoparticles in really large scale areas by using a template assisted method recently. So we are now able to array our catalysts on the surface in a given way, which may give us new optical properties like collective modes from the nanoparticles or new catalytic properties by approaching the catalysts. So I hope I have summarized quite quickly different single molecule, single particle and bulk methods in order to trace these chemical reactions on plasmonic surfaces, mostly mediated by sunlight. So we have used in most of these experiments a sunlight simulator as a source of light with the idea of mimicking real conditions for like sunlight-driven catalysis. So last, of course, we have been also working with more like photonic structures, right? Like semiconductors, in where like photocatalysis, it's much well known and much more explored, I would say. But here there are also some things that we can play around, like creating special photonic modes inside these cavities. So also playing a little bit with the optics in order to get much more energy inside of these resonators in order to catalyze chemical reactions on the surface. So here, for example, is titanium dioxide, which is a much well-known photocatalyst. And we have created some different sizes in order to have one special case where we have this excitation, which is called anapole excitation, where there is a lot of energy inside the material that allow us to trigger a chemical reaction. So that's all. I hope I have shown you different ways of tracking photo, thermal, and electrocatalysis and the chemical reaction pathways that we can activate by using sunlight with these materials, how we can get information in space, time, and chemical information at the single particle level, and new materials in order to create these energy conversion cascade processes. So finally, I want to thank all the funding sources, and also this is a book that's going to be released next month. It's the first book on plasmonic catalysis that we have been editing with my colleague Pedro Camargo from the University of Helsinki, and we hope it's a door for like further contributions in the field, which is quite recent, but it has been moving like quite fast in the last years. So with that, I want to thank all my team and all the people that have made possible all these things that I have shown you. And this is our new Nano Institute in Munich that belongs to the LMU. And yeah, we hope to host you. If you visit Munich, just let us know. So thank you very much. And